Good evening. The big story. General elections in the country are 6 months away, and currently we are bang in the middle of five state assembly elections. One of the biggest issues in this election season is farmers' distress. And to highlight their plight, over 1 lakh farmers have landed in the national capital. Farmers from 200 organizations have marched to Delhi to protest at the Ram Leela Maidan. Their key demands: debt relief, better minimum support price, and farmer suicides. With less than 2 weeks to go for the winter session of Parliament, these farmers are demanding a special session dedicated to farmers and passage of two bills, the Freedom of Indebtedness Bill and a bill to generate remunerative MSP. How will the NDA government deal with anger among the farmer community in the upcoming session of Parliament? We will discuss that ahead. But first, let's go across to my colleague Archana Shukla to get a sense of what is causing this anger among farmers in the country.
Well, Parikshit, the demands by the current protesting farmers in Delhi put the spotlight on exactly two of the biggest ailments: indebtedness and lower prices for their crops. Despite record crop production in the last 2 years, and many of the crops are selling below their minimum support price, and farmers have been protesting to get remunerative pricing for their crops. The government did move on this one by announcing MSP for kharif crops at 1.5 times their cost of production, but the ground reality is different. When kharif crops actually hit the mandis, almost 9 crops were selling below MSP. Currently, tuwar, urad, moong are selling anywhere between 28% to 33% below their minimum support price. If you look at the other figure, jowar, bajra, maize and ragi are again selling anywhere between 12% to 26% below their MSP. Kharif oil seeds are selling 5% to 20% below their MSP, and soya prices have been softer by 5%. Those figures will come up on your screen right now. A direct impact of lower kharif pricing and delayed payments is seen in the rabi sowing, because if the money is not in the hands of the farmers, they don't have cash to go on for the sowing for the rabi crops. And rabi sowing overall is down 7.3%, rabi pulses is down 10%, and coarse cereal sowing is down 31%. Now, despite promises of doubling farmers' income, and even as farmers are receiving large subsidies for various inputs like fertilizers, power and irrigation, the gross farm revenues fell 14% on an average between 2000 and 2016, in 16 years. Low income as a result of this means farmers are unable to repay the debt that they raised to cultivate, and they are in that cycle of indebtedness. According to NSSO data, more than 70% of the rural population has one or more standing loans, and nearly 74% of the farmer households were in debt in 2013. In the last 25 years, the percentage of farmer households in debt has increased by more than 12 percentage points. And a large indebtedness has reportedly been the biggest reason for farmer suicides in the country, a malaise that has not yet been cured. Look at the farmer suicide data. It has only gone up since 2013. And after 2015, the government, the National Crimes Bureau, has stopped publishing the farmer suicide rate, and only some provisional figures have been shared. So we know that the actual number is actually much more than 11,370 farmer suicides that were reported in 2016. So, you know, these are some of the key and the biggest reasons and ailments that rural India is dealing with. And we would wait to see how the government actually moves on that. Back to you, Parikshit.
Right, Archana, thanks very much for joining us. Clearly, it's a very complicated problem. And how will the BJP government resolve this and address this anger ahead of elections? Joining us now is a very special guest, Mr. P Sainath, veteran journalist, joins us on the show. He's also the founding editor of People's Archive of Rural India. Mr. Sainath, thanks very much for speaking to CNBC TV 18. Our first question, there's been a lot of talk around loan waivers in all the poll-bound states. Congress has made farmers' distress the single biggest issue in this election. And also, these farmers who are protesting in Delhi today, approximately 2 lakh farmers, one of their key demands is a one-time complete loan waiver. Is that possible, and is that even a solution?
You know, firstly, I'd like to add a point to something that was said earlier by your correspondent about the National Crime Records Bureau not publishing data since 2015. Not only did they suppress the data since 2015, the government, they even shut down the National Crime Records Bureau. And much of the media never reported this, They shut down the National Crime Records Bureau, merged it into a ridiculous institution called the Bureau of Police Research and Development. And when they found that they had substantially damaged themselves for lack of data, they demerged the NCRB, and it re-emerges in April this year. So in the history of India, it has never happened that a major department, that too a division of the Home Ministry, was shut down, merged, demerged, and re-emerged. It tells you what kind of an attitude they have towards truth-telling and towards all, even those numbers which they are suppressing are very flawed. About the loan waiver, firstly, you know, you need, it's not just a loan waiver, you need a proper reappraisal of your credit system. From the mid-90s onwards, a hell of a lot of money, when all the finance ministers of the past two decades tell you, we have doubled agricultural credit, we have trebled agricultural credit, and quadrupled it, they're telling you the truth. Except that the money isn't going to the agriculturist. We spent many, please read the budgets from 2006 to, I mean, forever, after 2006. You repeatedly redefined what is priority sector lending until tomorrow, if India's richest industrialist opens a cold storage in Connaught Place, he will get agricultural rates of interest. In the process of the last 20 years, we substantially shifted agricultural credit out of the hand of agriculture into the hands of agribusiness. Please look at the size of the loans that have grown, 10 crores and above, 25 crores and above. Do you know, now I think all your viewers are familiar with NABARD, the National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development. For the 2016-2017 potential linked credit plan of NABARD, would you believe that in the state of Maharashtra, 53% of agricultural credit flow went to Mumbai city. It went to Mumbai city and suburbs. Now, Mumbai city has no agriculturists, but it has plenty of agribusiness. We've been doing this for 20 years. 20 years ago, nobody was asking for a loan waiver. Hmm. Nobody. Hmm. But we have taken credit out of the hands of the agriculturist, who is then forced to turn to the sahukar. So most farmers end up with multiple loans which they are unable to repay. You're right. Going to have to view this in this framework and also understand that you are waiving thousands of crores more per capita for the Vijay Malias, the Mehul Choksis, the Nirav Modis, but you're not willing to look at 50,000 rupees or 20,000 rupees for someone who's going to kill himself over it.
Right. Mr. Sainath, this
is Archana. It's a vicious cycle, isn't it, Mr. Sainath? Archana has a question for you.
Yeah. Mr. Sainath, this is Archana Shukla from the Mumbai studios joining in. You know, I had also read some of the articles that you'd written in the past where you say that a loan waiver is necessary in the interim before the farmers can get back on their feet. So do you think the way the loan waiver schemes are being announced across the country by political parties, particularly during, you know, as their election manifestos, is the right way to go forward on this?
You know, first of all, I think that there aren't that many loan waivers declared across the country. If you look nationally, there have been two loan waivers historically in independent India. And by the way, there were several loan waivers and legislation for that in colonial India, because the colonial Raj after 1857 understood what agrarian distress leads to. There was a Punjab Indebtedness Act of 1934, Land Alienation and Indebtedness Act. And in in Tamil Nadu, in Madras Presidency in 1937. They, in those days, there were no nationalized banks. It was all sahukari money. The announcements of loan waiver, of course, there are political parties that will make them announce them. And then you don't really have anything happening on the ground to implement them. Maharashtra is a classic example. So a hell of a lot of people haven't. By the way, a loan waiver doesn't mean that you're going and giving someone some money. You are actually waiving them waiving the amount that they have to pay up to a certain amount. Every year, Archana, every single year, you have had a budget annexure called Statement of Revenue Foregone, in which you give away up to 5,34,000 crores for the waive. You waive excise duties worth 250,000 crores. You waive corporate direct income tax 78,000 crores. Customs duties waivers about another 2 lakh crores. So please understand that that's a recurring every year waiver. Now, I agree with you that the loan waiver is a relief. It is not a solution. It's not. It cannot be, because there are much bigger problems. Unless you tackle the credit structure, the farmer will return to the same situation the next year.
You know, Mr. Sainath, that is the point. When you're saying we're not addressing the key problem over here, do you think that election after election, every political party, whether they are in the opposition or in the government, are only offering sops to people? You know, they're offering medicines which can provide temporary relief. Look at garlic farmers in Rajasthan. Today, in some places, garlic is selling for 2 rupees a kilo. 3 years back, it was 80 rupees a kilo. And garlic farmers say there was a time when the government was encouraging us to sow garlic. And today, when there is a glut, there are no takers. So do you think that, you know, be it the Congress or the BJP, none of them are coming up with a comprehensive policy?
This is the reason why the Swaminathan Commission report, and for God's sake, the report was not just about loan waivers, it was about 100 things, okay? And this is why you need a price stabilization fund. You need a price stabilization fund. You've had that sometimes invoked in the case of petroleum, for instance. Hello? You need a price stabilization fund to be able to deal with that kind of shock fluctuation. Demonetization caused devastation in prices across the country, and Adivasi farmers who had shifted from subsistence food crop to crops like tomato and had taken 30,000 to 2 lakh loans were devastated when they found their tomatoes selling at 20 to 25 paisa a kilogram. Now, this, I'm warning you, is going to keep happening. It's going to keep happening because of the way you've thrown the farmer and producer to the wolves. And that's why, by the way, to discuss those other issues, you need a special session of parliament. You need a special session of parliament to pass these two bills. The All India Kisan Sangharsh Coordination Committee has drawn up those two bills, but after, those are the first steps. Then you need to discuss the mega water crisis in this country. You need to discuss the issues of women, Dalit and Adivasi farmers in this country. You need to discuss the Swaminathan report threat there. You need, and this is very important, what is extremely important is that you need to discuss and reverse the decline of public investment in agriculture. If you don't do that, you're not going to solve the problem.
Okay. All right, Mr. Sainath, thanks very much for speaking to CNBC TV 18. It's clearly a complex problem, and our politicians need to take a more comprehensive view of that. Let's go across to all our guests now. We are joined by All India Kisan Sabha Secretary, Joint Secretary, Mr. Vijoo Krishnan. We also have spokesperson of the BJP, Narendra Taneja, with us. We also have the former chairman of Institute of Rural Management, Yoginder, Alagh, and Kiran Vissa, spokesperson of Swaraj Abhiyan, will be joining us as well. Let me go across to Narendra Taneja of the BJP first. Narendra Taneja, P Sainath outlined how this is becoming a major crisis, and be it the Congress or the BJP, neither parties are taking a comprehensive view of it. Neither of them are looking at the Swaminathan Committee report properly. Today, there are key demands. There should be a special session for farmers in the winter session of Parliament. Both these bills, Freedom of Indebtedness Bill, Bill to Generate Remunerative MSP, both of them should be passed in this winter session of Parliament. Can this be a reality? You from the ruling party, please tell us.
No, but please just tell me whether agriculture is a central subject or is a safe subject. Kindly tell me. Kindly educate me.
You know, Mr. Taneja, there is a larger demand for these two bills to be passed. This is a demand for all the farmers who are there at Ramlila Maidan today. I guess they are seeking some answers from you on how seriously will this special session be considered. Please answer them.
No. I'm just, this is what I'm trying to say. I listened to the lecture by Mr. Sainath. I have high regard for him. And all that he was saying is nothing new. He has been saying this for years. And I know his political ideas and his ideology. We know, all know it very well. You see, all BJP is a very bad party, according to him. He keeps saying that. You just go on social media and see what he has to say about the government. But that's not important. The important thing is that what the efforts that we have put in at the level of the center in order to, you know, make life better for our farmers. And we are focusing more on transforming the entire rural economy. We have to look at the whole thing more holistically. Look at the rural economy. If we just look at only farmers, of course we are doing that. But together with that, we are also looking at the economy as a whole. What has happened over the years, you see the number of people who are dependent on, if you look at the net number, that has gone up. At the same time, you know, look at the farmland and all that. That, of course, is given by nature. There's nothing you can do about it. It's not good. It's not increasing. So, which means that you need to rework the entire rural economy. That's precisely what we are doing. Focus on agriculture, modernization, better seeds, you know, neem urea, but at the same time taking roads there, taking irrigation there, taking water there, taking electricity there, taking, you know, new ideas and technology there, so that the rural families are not dependent only on farming.
Mr.
So
Taneja.
That they can also set up, you know, new industries and many industry and so on and so forth. That also, as far as the protest is concerned, of course, democracy, and of course, farmers have the right to protest. Hmm. But we also have to see these 200 organizations, who these organized, majority of them are political organization with political affiliation, like Yoginder is a politician. Who everybody knows that. There are many organizations, but there is nothing wrong with it. In democracy, you can do that. The question is that, you know, states are need to focus more on that, whether states are ruled by BJP, Congress, or TMC, or any other political party. Because if you are just basically because the elections are coming
the
to
states
Delhi,
are ruled by BJP.
Mr. Taneja,
but these are different states.
Mr. Taneja,
and
Mr.
different
Taneja.
Government. Yes, BJP, but different governments have different states have different BJP government. Why only this thing? Look at West Bengal. Look at Punjab. Look at Karnataka. Look at Kerala. So unless you want to only discuss politics, what I'm saying is they are coming to Delhi for political reasons because elections are coming.
Okay.
And there
okay.
are political motives behind it. And you know, and that's precisely the reason. Your reporter said 1 lakh farmers. You added 1 lakh more. You said two lakh farmers. 2 lakh people are protesting. How many of them are farmers? How many of them are political activists? Mr. Sainath himself is also an activist.
Mr. Taneja, if I can just take a point here. Two things that you've been mentioning. One. That, you know, these are not farmers, these are agitators and these are, you know, political parties coming on the field.
Not all of them.
Most of them, according to you. And secondly, that this is a state subject. And if we go to look at it, most of the states currently in the country are ruled by BJP. And secondly, the larger premise or the larger policy is being designed by the center. And if we only talk of one of the biggest policy moves that the central government made recently was to increase the kharif pricing, kharif MSP, by 1.5 times. But we haven't seen that actually reflect on the ground. Parikshit had been touring, states and mandis. I had been touring the rural regions, and we found that none of the producers are actually getting
allow
that. So, you know, bringing the politics part up front and not looking at the real crisis in the farm was our question. Why are the political parties not addressing the real crisis?
It's a very long question. Now give me a little time on that. The question is that yes, we have designed these schemes because we care for the farmers. Farmers are top priority. We have designed and we are executing, but you would appreciate all these schemes. Look at the, for instance, delivery on the ground. That depends on the quality of governance in different states, whether they are ruled by us or they are ruled by other political party. Therefore, the result is different from state to state because agriculture is a state subject. When it comes to the delivery of this, it's not telecom, it's not petroleum and natural gas. Delivery, you have to go through states for everything.
So these, yes, we have done that. But at the same time, that does mean the states can't take their own initiative, whether they are BJP states or TMC or DMK or Congress or any other political, or you know, Naveen Pattnaik's state, any state. Please focus on that. You have not even once mentioned in your report that what does the constitution say, which basically you are saying the central government, Narendra Modi government, is responsible for everything. You are not even touching the real point, that is that this is essentially and basically a state subject. And that's what is important, whether BJP
or
non-BJP.
Let me,
that's not the
you know, Mr. Taneja, we'll get in other guests now. We'll get in more guests. Vijoo Krishnan is also joining us. He's the Joint Secretary of the All India Kisan Sabha. Vijoo Krishnan, thanks for waiting patiently. We have been hearing Mr. Narendra Taneja. He's saying that a lot has been done for the farmers in the country to give them the right price, to give them more market access, to give them better roads as well. Would you call the BJP government anti-farmer? You know, what is also being said, that all these protests that we are seeing right now at Ram Lalia Maidan, to a great extent, these are politically motivated. How do you respond to that?
It has been a big, huge betrayal by the BJP government that has led to this kind of consistent protests that are coming up in our country. And this government is the most anti-farmer government we have seen in independent India. It had raised a lot of hopes in 2014, but each one of the promise that was made to the farmers have been betrayed. That is why we are here out in protest. Surely, we don't shy away that we have a politics. Different groups are here. Each one of us has our own politics. And today, but we have united here, setting aside our differences for the interest of the farmers. The farmers of our country are in distress. They are forced to commit suicide. They are not getting remunerative prices. They are not even getting cheap credit.
Okay.
In fact, I would like to add to what Sainath mentioned. 615 accounts in the last 4 years have been getting about 60,000 crores as agricultural credit. Just 615 accounts.
Okay.
That is more than 90 crores per account. Which farmer is this being helped in this manner by this government? It is a government of the corporates.
Okay. Let's get new,
promoting
more views.
A corporate model of loot.
Let's get more views, Mr. Vijoo Krishnan. I'll get in Yoginder
Alagh.
We're running out of time. I'd like
this
to get in Yoginder Alagh.
Politics.
Yoginder Alagh, one of the key demands is that MSP should be implemented as per the Swaminathan Committee formula, 50% plus cost of cultivation. But many say this is just not possible. People like Ashok Gulati say this will create a national crisis. Do you think that we're taking a very narrow view? We take a view of the agriculture sector, farmers, farmer suicides, election to election. There is no comprehensive view that is being taken.
Well, to begin with, you have to be very clear that the MSP really works for a few states and a few crops where government actually purchases. Otherwise, it is more a declaration. NABARD doesn't really have the money. There have been schemes like direct benefit to the farmer, which we know have not worked. And basically, I'm not quoting any new statistics. It's the Commission on Agricultural Costs and Prices, which has told us that during the last 3 or 4 years, the terms of trade have moved against agriculture. Which in other words means that people like you and me, our income has gone up by about, on an average, by about 6.5%, which is the growth in per capita consumption as compared to a growth rate of 7 to 8% in income. But for the farmer, income has fallen. Income in the sense of the price that he pays for what he buys against the price that he gets for what he purchases by around 5%. So what you're seeing is basically the fact that really we don't have intervention mechanisms which are effective. Yes, some have been declared. We have agriculture is a concurrent subject. Both the central government and the state government are responsible. They have declared some schemes. But if you look at things like the agricultural produce market, the direct benefit schemes, purchases of the kind that were happening in Madhya Pradesh, you spread it over a whole lot of different crops. There are a lot of field reports, plus the statistics of the Commission on Agricultural Costs and Prices, which are saying that these things are not working.
Right.
And that is where you are getting this people on the road.
Right, right. Thank you, Mr. Alagh. Let me get in Kiran Vissa, who's spokesperson of Swaraj Abhiyan, in one of the groups that is participating in this rally. Mr. Vissa, how do you look at, you know, what, how would you take this rally forward? How would you take this protest forward? You're bringing in everyone, all farmers, political parties who are supporting you on the field right now. How would you take this forward from here on if the government is not moving on your request for a 21-day parliamentary session?
See, one thing I just want to say in response to the BJP spokesperson who was speaking, that, you know, the people who are protesting here, they are all real farmers. You know, I come from Telangana in Andhra Pradesh. You know, we have a farmers organization which is working there extensively. There are people from families of farmers who have committed suicide who are coming here. They are coming here to, you know, with the resolve that no more farmer suicide should happen in the country. And there are Adivasi farmers, there are women farmers, there are tenant farmers. From the poorest sections, they have come here. So if the government is not ready to listen to their voice and kind of brush it away just using political arguments, I think that will be a real pity. They may face a political backlash, but definitely they will lose the goodwill of the farmers across the country. So I think that should be very clear. And as far as taking this struggle forward, I think that, you know, from the last year, in the same month, when 50,000 farmers came and did a farmers' parliament here, and we adopted the two Kisan Mukti bills on these two main demands. Until now, I think that whole those two issues have become national, you know, issues of debate, and every party across the country in every state elections is actually making promises on one or two of these issues. So what we
we can understand
the 2019
Kiran,
elections
we can understand
will be
anger of farmers
on the issues,
but I'm going to put some questions to Yoginder Alagh and Narendra Taneja very quickly. We've completely run out of time, just about 15 seconds each. Narendra Taneja, do you think the government would be better placed to go ahead and look at some of the other measures that the Swaminathan committee had recommended? Unfinished agenda and land reform, quantity and quality of water being provided, technology fatigue, access to credit, and remunerative marketing.
We have accepted most of the, you know, recommendation of Swaminathan Commission, most of them, and others we are looking at them seriously. We are already working for the modernization of the rural economy. That's our focus. Majority of farmers are with us. They vote us. We are the one who have taken electricity to every village, irrigation to every village, help farmers, you know, open bank account. We have given them LPG cylinders. We are the one who are doing all this. All these people, Yogesh Yadav, when did he become a farmer? He was nominated, he was a UGC member appointed by the Sonia Gandhi family and Rahul Gandhi family. Don't we know that? When did he become a farmer? You see, now the, and he's the main spokesperson, the main organizer. It's all politics. But nothing
Very
wrong
quickly,
with it. But if you are
what
a politician,
is immediate demand
say
from the BJP government
a political
from
agenda.
The upcoming session of parliament? Vijoo Krishnan, very quickly, what is your immediate demand from the upcoming winter session of parliament?
No, we are demanding that there be a special session of parliament for the discussing the issues of the farmers, the agrarian crisis, and to pass these two bills. That is our demand. And all
and
political
that
parties,
happen,
21
and that
parties
happen,
have come out in support. If that doesn't happen, it is the government is taking such a stance, anti-farmer stance, at their own peril. We will intensify our struggles.
Okay.
There has been an unprecedented solidarity.
It's our political talk. Please do
much
that during the election time.
Which will come.
When you are
we
running
seen,
for parliament,
okay.
please
so
do that.
Massive support from all
saying this
of
protest
farmers.
Will intensify. Of course, farmers' distress will be one of the major issues in the run-up to 2019 as well. We'd like to thank all our guests, Kiran Vissa, Narendra Taneja, Yoginder Alagh, and Vijoo Krishnan for joining us. We've completely run out of time, but this is a story that we will track very, very closely.